Hi again. So we're continuing chapter one. We're going to start reflecting transactions. So we will recognize transactions and then we will reflect them on the equation. Now, keep in mind that each and every time you're going to have a new transaction, you're going to use at least two accounts in each and every transaction. It's always going to be at least two or more. So we're going to have some examples. So let's say the company just started the business, they just registered the company, they just have their own place, and then they're going to raise cash by issuing stocks. So that will be the first transaction to record. Now, always think, what are the two accounts that I need? And then the second step is to remind yourself where each and every account is classified under the accounting equation, and then decide if you're going to increase that account or decrease it. There's always an increase and decrease, okay? So when you raise, for example, $100,000 cash from issuing stocks, that means we're gonna have two accounts, cash account and common stock. Cash is an asset, common stock is stockholders' equity. Cash is going to increase by $100,000. Remember, it's the company's cash. It's not the owner's cash, it's the company's cash. So we as accountants in that company, from our perspective, our cash is increasing by $100,000. And on the other side of the equation, the common stock is increasing by $100,000 as well. So under the assets, we know that cash is an asset. We will say cash plus $100,000. And then on the other side of the equation, we will say that common stock also increases by $100,000. Always keep in mind something super, super important, that the equation has to remain equal forever. No matter how many transactions we're gonna have, no matter how old the company is, the equation is always gonna be equal after recording any transaction. So that was the first one. We just raised cash. Now we have enough cash. The next step, let's say we're going to buy a piece of equipment for $20,000. And let's say that we're gonna pay cash for it, okay? So the two accounts that we're gonna need here are equipment, which is going to increase by $20,000. The other account is the cash, which is going to decrease by $20,000. Okay, because we're gonna spend cash and get equipment. So to record that, we're going to say cash decrease, so which is a minus, by $20,000, and then equipment increase by $20,000. Now the question is the equation still equal? Well, it is, because under the assets side, you can clearly see that you have a decrease of $20,000 as well as an increase of $20,000 under the assets. So the total assets is not changing. It's still $100,000, okay? And then I still have $100,000 on the other side of the equation, which keeps us balanced. So, okay, let's record one more transaction. Let's say that we're going to buy supplies, which is another asset, but this time we're not gonna pay cash for it. We're gonna buy supplies on account. Now, when we say on account or on credit, on account or on credit, it means the same thing. It means that we're not gonna pay now, it means that we will pay in future. Now remember, if you're gonna pay something in future, for an amount that is already owed by you to someone, that becomes accounts payable, which is one of your liability accounts. So you're gonna have a supplies account. Remember, we're gonna have two accounts for this transaction. So supplies, which is an asset, and let's say the supplies are worth $1,000, just an example. And then because we did not pay cash for them, our cash account is not going to be affected. So we're gonna have a liability account, which is accounts payable. And then usually we write down accounts payable like that, A/B, okay? Accounts payable. That is also going to increase by $1,000. Because when payable goes up by 1,000, it means that what we owe is being increased from zero. There was no liability before, and now it's being increased from zero to $1,000. So we owe $1,000. So liability goes up by $1,000. Now, if you look at the equation, if you try to find out if it is still equal or not, well, look at the asset side. We just added $1,000. Look at the other side of the equation. Under liability, we just added $1,000 as well. So the equation is still equal. Okay, let's have a fourth transaction. And this time, let's say that we are going to provide a service to a customer for cash, okay? So remember, if I'm gonna receive cash, so let's say it was $4,000 worth of service, okay? So under the assets, we will just go back to the cash account and we will just say plus 4,000 because we provided the service and then immediately we got cash on spot, okay? So my cash was increased by $4,000. And then remember that on the other side of the equation, usually revenue reflects on stockholders' equity. So I will say that revenue, and then again, remember that it reflects indirectly. Revenue, it's not classified usually under the stockholders' equity, but it will reflect on it positively. And later on, we will explain more in details and how the relationship between revenue and stockholders' equity looks like. But for now, you just need to know that revenue, once it goes up, equity also goes up. So revenue plus $4,000. So we provided a service, it's worth $4,000, it's considered a revenue, $4,000, then cash goes up by $4,000. The equation is still equal. Okay, now let's do another transaction. Let's do our fifth transaction. This time we're gonna say that we provided another service for a customer for $3,000, but this time we provided a service on account or on credit. That means we're not gonna get the cash right away from the customer. We're going to finish the service today, so it's going to be officially a revenue, a service revenue, but we cannot increase the cash because we did not get cash yet. Instead, we will use accounts receivable. A/R means accounts receivable. And remember, accounts receivable is one of our assets because there's some cash in that customer's pocket now that is belonging to us, at least from our perspective as accountants. Plus 3,000. And then on the other side of the equation, there will be revenue again. Okay. And by the way, we're going to call it service revenue. So I'm just going to add an S here, S there, service revenue. And then I will add $3,000 as well. Now the equation is still equal. Okay. Remember, so accounts receivable means that this is cash that will be received. It will be received in future. It's not yet cash. Okay. Now let's talk about expenses. Let's have an expense recorded. So let's say that we have to buy. Let's pay for advertising. We're gonna advertise. It's a new business. We have to advertise it. And then let's say that we were provided. An advertising event, or maybe it was an ad on a magazine for, let's say, $500. And then we paid cash for it immediately, okay? So we're gonna have an expense account. We're gonna call that expense account advertising expense. And then we paid cash, so our cash will be involved as well. So the two accounts here are cash. And then if I'm gonna pay cash, that means my cash will decrease by $500. And then my expense, which is also going to reflect on stockholders' equity, just like revenues, but remember that expenses normally reflect negatively on the stockholders' equity. That means whenever we have an expense, the stockholders' equity will decrease. It's not going to increase, it will decrease, okay? So advertising expense, we will, although it's increasing, but what I'm trying to show here on the equation on how is that expense going to reflect on the equity. So I will just say that it will reflect negatively. It's gonna be minus 500, okay? So in my equation is still equal. I have $500 decrease on under the assets, and then I have another $500 decrease of equity on the other side of the equation. Okay, so that's how we reflect that's how we reflect transactions on the equation. You're always going to have two accounts. Those two accounts might be not on two different places in the equation. They might be in the same place of the equation. So if you look back in the assets, for example, let's go back to that equipment that we purchased for cash. The two accounts that we used, the cash and the equipment, they were both assets. But one of them was going up, the other one was going down. So although they are both on the one side of the equation, but the total assets did not change because we got a plus 20,000 and we got a minus 20,000, which is not going to change the total assets, which will keep the equation equal, okay? And then you notice that in some transactions we had two accounts increasing or two accounts decreasing, or two accounts, one of them is increasing, the other one is decreasing, okay? And then eventually, after you record we're gonna record transactions each and every day within a period, within the accounting period, which is normally a month or a year. And then eventually, at the end of that period, we're going to calculate the ending balances of each and every one of those accounts. The ending balance, it's actually the result of all the pluses and minuses we had for all those accounts. So for example, if we go back to the cash, we started with increasing it by 100,000, and then we decreased it by 20,000, and then we increased it by 4,000, and then we decreased it by $500. So then you can calculate the sum of cash, and so you do 100,000 plus minus 20, that's 80. 80 plus 4, that's 84. Minus 500, that makes it 83,500. So my ending balance for cash is $83,500. And then you do the same thing for equipment, supplies, accounts receivable, accounts payable, and each and every account that you have used during that period. And then what we will talk about next is how to deal with those ending balances. What is the next step after you calculate the ending balances for each and every account? That will be in the next video.